Good afternoon. Thanks, everybody, for coming. Thanks, everybody, for coming.
This is our issue.
I'm thrilled to welcome you to our DACA seminar event with Professor Jack Faba. Before I introduce Professor Faba, I wanted to thank our sponsors, the Harvard Graduate School of Education, the Inequality in America Initiative, Harvard University Faculty of Arts and Sciences, the Committee on Ethnicity, Migration, and Rights, the Charles Warren Center for Studies in American History, Harvard Act on a Dream, and Define America. I also want to thank my fellow co-organizers who aren't here this afternoon, Walter Johnson and Kirsten Weld, and a big thanks to Robin McDowell and to Cage Kim for their amazing logistical help. We really couldn't pull off this is a 15-event seminar. Really couldn't have pulled it off without them. So a couple words about this DACA seminar. This is an effort that spans most of this semester, a series of events, conversations, talks, music, art, politics, and more. An effort that we're engaged in service to opening up the space of learning and dialogue to our campus and larger community around questions related to immigration broadly, to the termination of DACA and TPS, deportations, the current state of our immigration policy, and its implications for young people, parents, families, communities, scholars, artists, workers, policymakers, and practitioners. We see this wind down period, and this program is set to end on March 5th, in 18 days. But we see this as a window through which to discuss not only DACA, but also a host of immigration-related issues that impact a wide range of our American public. Through a series of events on campus, again set to run between late January and early March, now through April, it's our hope to bring together a diverse set of stakeholders in an effort to gain a better understanding of the issues at hand while engaging various viewpoints. So a couple previews of coming attractions. This Thursday, at the Divinity School, we'll host a panel called Strategies from the Frontlines of Immigration Activism. And then next week, anthropologist Leo Chavez will be here on Tuesday, February 20th at 4 p.m. And then on Wednesday, at the Oberon at 7 o'clock, our event, Little Tiny Walls, a performance and discussion featuring six-time Grammy Award winner Arturo Farrell, Cornel West, and myself. So these are events that you don't want to miss. We've got our poster outside and buttons, but you can also get the latest updates at dacaseminar.fas.harvard.edu. That's dacaseminar.fas.harvard.edu. So without further ado, it's my sincere honor and pleasure to introduce Professor Jacqueline Faba, who's professor of practice in health and human rights at the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health and director of research at the Harvard FXB Center for Health and Human Rights. From 1997 to 2001, Professor Faba directed the Human Rights Program at the University of Chicago. Prior to 1997, she was a practicing human rights lawyer in London and at the European Court of Human Rights in Strasbourg. She's published extensively on issues of transnational child migration, refugee protection, children's rights, and citizenship. Professor Faba is really well known within human rights community. She currently serves on the Board of Scholars Board of the Scholars at Risk Network, the World Peace Foundation, the Institute on Statelessness and Inclusion, and the Journal of Refugee Studies. She's a frequent advisor to UNHCR, UNICEF, IOM, and civil society organizations worldwide working on forced migration-related issues. So please join me in giving a warm welcome, Professor Jacqueline Faba.
you also so much to you and to Wharton Cousin for organizing this seminar. It's really wonderful when one sees one's colleagues really stepping up to the plate and really putting the commitments that we, some of us, have into practice, not only in our scholarship, in our writing, but also in activism on campus. And I think at this time of all times, it's so important to be visible as making a statement on these, some of these really excruciating issues. So I was delighted to be invited to make some remarks to this seminar. I've had the pleasure of attending a couple of previous seminars last semester, which were great, and I think that having this ongoing conversation is really an opportunity for us to, you know, think, take stock of where we are and also think about where we may go. So I was asked to talk about child migrants, which is a topic I've done a lot of work on, and that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to focus on some of the tensions and paradoxes that arise when dealing with this particular subset of migrants and refugees. Never before have the interests of undocumented child migrants and refugees, nowadays called children on the move generally, had so much attention. You could really say it's a kind of us too, hashtag us too moment. Many similarities, actually. In a short space of years, we've moved from virtual silence on a topic that deep down everybody knew about. We've left behind the silence, not so much a silence created by ignorance or by denial, but in this case, I think, by a very deep ambivalence. And I'm going to have more to say about this ambivalence that I think is at the heart of public policy towards child migrants. 10 years ago, when I was already working on this issue, and I'm sure Roberta was too, Americans would be very surprised to learn that between 8 and 10,000 unaccompanied children were crossing the border every year from Central America and Mexico, ending up in the U.S., often in detention, in so-called shelters, which really were detention, sometimes for prolonged periods of time. And then all of a sudden, summer of 2014, summer of 2015, last summer, 2017, there was this massive increase in the numbers of unaccompanied children and families crossing the border, and suddenly the issue kind of hit the headlines. President Obama talked about a humanitarian crisis, and since then, really, the issue of children accompanied and unaccompanied has never really been far from the headlines. But I think this ambivalence towards child migrants remains. So what does the ambivalence consist of? Why do I say it? We have an ambivalent attitude. I think because policymakers and publics have this kind of bifurcated response. I think on the one hand, and we see this unfortunately very evident today, there's this sense of hostility. Why should we take responsibility for other people's children? They're not our children. And in fact, they're not really like our children, because these kids who come across the border really are de facto adults. They've had tough lives, they've made all these decisions, they've probably been working, so they really aren't, certainly not our children, and maybe they aren't really children at all. And in fact, it's very common to have people say, it's not just that we don't have responsibility towards them, they are sending these kids, they're kind of throwaways, they're kind of their problem kids, who are they're sending to us, kids who can't really make a go of it in their own countries, are coming here. And I've had, I mean, probably you've had this experience too, anybody who works in this field, you hear this again and again, that these kids coming across the border are kind of throwaways. So you have this on the one hand, and you get this attitude from not just policymakers, of course, but from the public at large, the sense of, you know, people should have responsibility for their own children. Children, you know, need to be cared for. Why should these kids come unaccompanied and expect our sympathy, expect our social services, expect our resources? And on the other hand, of course, you have the sense of compassion, you have the sense that these are children, they're innocent, they are vulnerable, the sense of contrition, sometimes a very sentimental idea of kind of these poor little vulnerable things who are not really rights bearers or agents or independent actors, but these kind of little vulnerable nuggets who should be protected, who should be kind of recipients of discretion. We should be doing the right thing by them, shouldn't really change the law, shouldn't really have kind of a proper legal platform, but at least we should sort of be nice to them. And so I think this is the dominant discourse still, after all these years that we have, this kind of tension. And over the years, people often have said, you know, the reason that child migrants and unaccompanied children haven't had proper attention is because nobody knew they existed. They were kind of invisible. And that's really, it was just like an oversight. And I've always pushed back against that, because I think that even though many people at large might be surprised by the scale of migration, policymakers have known for a long time that there are unaccompanied children arriving, that this is an issue. And they know because they're paying for all these, many of these kids to be in detention for long periods of time. But we are still in this position where child migrants, and I'm using this term broadly to encompass asylum seekers, refugees, undocumented children, stateless children, the whole kind of panoply. And to some extent, even, you know, children who are migration affected because their parents have left and they are stuck wherever they're stuck and finding it difficult to reunify. All these children still don't have much of a legal platform for exercising their rights. And I'll have more to say about that in a minute. But before I talk about the US and the situation here, which is now, you know, extreme, you know, as Roberto says, we have 18 days left for this kind of major potential debacle. Let's just think about the rest of the world. So everybody in this room will be familiar with that searing image of Alan Kurdi, the little boy, Syrian boy. And that's one example of this kind of us two moment. That image changed European policy for a while, undoubtedly. I tracked the statements of policymakers, both, you know, Merkel and, you know, other heads of state, but also the European Union and members of the European Parliament. And clearly, that image was a trigger for a kind of sense of collective guilt. And it was, I think, probably a trigger for the decision to really relax the Dublin Convention and the Dublin rules, which again I'll say more about in a second. But this idea that people, even if they didn't have a clear legal right, could just cross borders across Europe and end up in Germany or Sweden or the UK, whether they want, especially Germany and Sweden. So it produced this outpouring of sympathy, this outpouring of this kind of mea culpa emotion. And yet policy has now not really changed. So we're back to this ambivalence. There's with this outpouring of emotion, this sense of collective responsibility. And yet now, if we look at European policy, things have not really improved. Think of Australia. I don't know how many of you are familiar with Australian policy, but Australian policy is also really dramatically discriminatory. So some time ago, just before Christmas, on the internet, you'd see these images of little toddlers holding signs, well, more than toddlers, holding signs saying, "My second Christmas in detention." And this was a reference to the fact that Australia outsources all its international obligations to asylum seekers and refugees by forcing asylum seekers onto these desert kind of outcrops, now Christmas Island, Manus Island, so places where there really is absolutely no civil society. They're just sort of centers of detention for asylum seekers. And this goes on year after year. And despite international criticism and despite massive amounts of attention from the Committee on the Rights of the Child and many other UN bodies and human rights organizations, of course, this, I think you can only call it the human rights abomination, this continues. And so children are still in detention there. Children are still sewing their lips in desperation. You still have high levels of trauma, suicide attempts. Number three, think of sub-Saharan Africa. Think of what's happening to children who are fleeing this incredible civil rights, civil conflict in South Sudan. Yet again, South Sudan, you know, embroiled in conflict after all the hopes that kind of there were about the negotiated settlement, the peace, and so on. And think don't know how many of you follow the stories about what's happening in Libya, but the situation in Libya, again, is really acute. There are thousands, tens of thousands of migrants arriving from West Africa, from the whole continent, really, and some also from Syria and other Middle East danger spots, trying to get to Europe. And just like the US has outsourced its responsibilities to Mexico, so, and just like really the EU decided to outsource its responsibilities to Greece and Italy, so now Italy is also outsourcing its responsibilities clearly to Libya, and there's this kind of, you know, devil's bargain between Italy and Libya, which goes really like this: you keep these people there, you make sure they don't leave, and we will, you know, do what we can to assist you and to shore up the sort of regime that you have in place. And so we have a situation where there are these three, in terms of children, we gather from our colleagues working in the field, there are three different groups. There are groups who are living rough on the streets of major cities in Libya, now increasingly prey to traffickers, because of course, what are these kids going to do? What is their future? Where are they going to look for survival? And so promises of, you know, getting you a job in Amsterdam or finding a way for you to study in Paris sound very attractive, number one. Number two, there are hundreds of children still in these detention centers, overcrowded detention centers, which are controlled not so much by government, but by sort of different factions of criminal gangs. And number three, there are large numbers of children and adults, the children who are now being removed, returned to the countries of origin by IOM, by the International Organization of Migration, returned to the places that they had left, that they fled from. So you have, this is the situation in Libya. And again, despite a lot of attention, despite a lot of publicity and criticism, the situation continues. People continue to be removed. The prisons continue to be basically out of reach. No UN organization is allowed to have a base in Libya anymore. So UNHCR and UNICEF sort of go in and go out, but they're based in Tripoli. They're based outside Libya, in Tunis, I think, for the most part, and some in Cairo. So this is a really a terrifying situation, and it's one that's directly linked to EU policy. This is not just a fact of, you can say, oh, you know, American invasion of Libya, Gaddafi was overthrown, Libyan government disintegrated, yes. But this particular set of factors affecting migrants who no longer feel they can really leave from Turkey, this is a direct consequence, conscious consequence of EU policy. So I would say that this kind of us to moment, like the Me Too moment, is not really so far producing anything amounting to substantive change. Certainly some children are benefiting from discretion. We have many cases, and there are wonderful advocates who are fighting each case, so there are cases where children are getting permission to stay. Just like there are sexual predators who are being taken out. But the enduring change, I think, is elusive. And so the answer really is, what's changed? Not much. So let me now just take a little look at the situation in the US, and I know that most of the seminars have focused on the US, and so I'm maybe one of the people who looks more internationally, but I do think with, you know, March 5th coming up so soon, we really do need to take stock of where we are. And in a way, it's fascinating for me to see how this question of DACA has really been with us right since the president's, the candidacy of Trump. I mean, it's been one of the issues that's come up again and again. So I just decided to kind of, for the purposes of this conversation, just to track a little bit, you know, what has happened in these momentous 15 months, maybe a little bit before. Obviously, and I know there are going to be seminars on this, the ending of TPS is dramatic. The continued enforcement of removals and deportations continues in an unseemly way, and of course has devastating effects on families and on children and on communities, and the sense of impending doom is always there, both for immigrant communities and, of course, for the 3 million odd US citizen children whose parents are undocumented. So there's an enormous constituency. We're not just talking about individuals who are undocumented. We're talking about the ripple effects on large swaths of our community. But I think this irresponsible seesawing on DACA, which implicates, again, not just the 800 odd thousand DACA recipients, but their families. This kind of back and forth, this toying with people's lives, this kind of prolix kind of conversation on the heads of people's lives is pretty extraordinary. And as you track what's happened, it's affected all three branches of the US government, the executive, the legislature, and the judiciary. So I just want to kind of pick out some of the kind of key etapes as I see them. So on the campaign trail, as we all know, candidate Trump said he would immediately terminate President Obama's two illegal executive amnesties. So he's referring to DACA and DAPA, the deferral program for parents of U.S. citizen kids. And in a similar vein, a few months later, he derided this whole notion of a dreamer movement by kind of saying, well, what about our own American dream? What about our poor Americans? He said, we want our children, i.e. not their children, to be dreamers too. So he was kind of like, you know, really saying this whole notion of a dream is something that is American and we want to own. But then, of course, shortly after his inauguration, it's something that we've becoming used to now, he told ABC News apropos of DACA recipients, they shouldn't be very worried. I do have a big heart. We're going to take care of everybody. We don't want to harm these kids. We love the dreamers. So, you know, that's one of these many kind of statements that he's made. This kind of notion is not that they would have legal rights or that there's a question about long-term residence and the lives that has been built. This is kind of his whole subjective reaction, his largesse of heart. But then, of course, the tone has changed. And so you recall in February 2017, he kind of seemed to distinguish, and this, I guess, is what's also happening now, but, you know, I think Roberta and others might know more about this, between his own heart and his own sentiment as a father and grandfather on one hand, and what the politicians and the lawyers were telling him on the other hand. So he says, you know, what the law says exactly is what we should do is not what I want to do. It's one of the most difficult subjects. It's a very, very tough subject, he said. And we're going to deal with DACA with heart. But I have to deal with a lot of politicians, don't forget, and I have to convince them that what I'm saying is right. I love these. So you can see how he's setting this up as, you know, here am I, the humane person, and there are they kind of like insisting on these laws. Very convenient kind of rhetorical device, I think. And then, as we all know, on September the 5th, 2017, the Attorney General, Jeff Sessions, announced that the DACA program was being rescinded. And since DACA status has to be renewed every 2 years, applications new applications could no longer be accepted. And so, as we just said, you know, 18 days from today, on March the 5th, some DACA permits, for example, for kids to attend college and to work, will expire unless something happens before, something that allows a new channel for temporary or even less likely permanent legal immigration status. And of course, by March 2020, something doesn't change, all the dreamers will lose their status. Now, we know that following this announcement, there was a real kind of surge of activism, if you like, in the legislature. So Nancy Pelosi accused Trump of what she called a deeply shameful act of political cowardice and a despicable assault on innocent young people in communities across America. And Senator Murphy from Connecticut also said Trump's big heart comment, referencing Trump's big heart comments earlier, said it takes someone with a dark heart to do something as cruel and as pointless as this. And it wasn't just Democrats. Senator McCain argued, and it's a point that several lawsuits have made, and also a point that Professor May Nye's wonderful talk last semester, which she also made, Senator McCain has pointed out the inconsistency and, in a way, the kind of sleight of hand of the government on the one hand holding up promises that people rely on and then pulling back from those promises. So rescinding DACA at this time, said McCain, is an unacceptable reversal of the promises and the opportunities that have been conferred to individuals. Where people rely on an official undertaking and rely in a way to their detriment or the potential detriment, and as the Dreamers have done, they've come forward, they've identified themselves, they've identified their families, and then you withdraw that statement on which people have relied, that is a deceitful act. It violates a legal doctrine called estoppel. The doctrine of estoppel holds that where you make some sort of offer and somebody relies on it, then you're stopped from reversing it. You know, if you say to somebody, well, you know, you're a squatter, you're staying in my basement, you know what, I'll allow you to stay, and then you make improvements and you install heating and you fix the walls or whatever, and then you say, well, actually, you know what, no, you are a squatter after all, I'm going to get rid of you. That violates that doctrine of estoppel. And so in a similar way, I think, that was the point that McCain was making, and I think it's a point that several of the suits have made. And it's not just, of course, American politicians from both sides of the House who've made these comments. As we all know, politics makes for strange bedfellows and sometimes unexpected coalitions. And Pope Francis, who actually many of us are a fan of, including myself, made an interesting point. I don't know if you guys kind of picked it up, about the Dreamers, and interesting and useful maybe from the point of view of bringing in kind of, you know, the religious right. He said that if Trump were truly pro-life, which is not my position for sure, but he, Pope Francis said, if Trump were truly pro-life, he would understand that the family is the cradle of life and must be defended as a whole unit. So it's an interesting political strategy there. So much for those sort of moves. What about the judiciary? So again, this has been a very active process, and I must say, certainly some of us lawyers, I think, have felt that this has been a great moment. Now, of course, the Supreme Court is sitting there over our heads, but in terms of the lower echelons of the legal profession and the courts, the degree of activism and dynamism and creativity in trying to resist this these kind of anti-immigrant moves has been, I think, quite remarkable. So, and many constituencies have used the courts. So in September, 15 states were parties to a lawsuit filed in the District of Columbia trying to stop the repeal of DACA. After them, six Dreamers, so the kind of parties themselves, decided to launch a lawsuit. Universities have used the law, so the University of California, which has over 4,000 undocumented students, has filed a suit against the Department of Homeland Security. And Janet Napolitano, who now is president of the UC system, called the rescission unconstitutional, unjust, and unlawful. Backward thinking, far-reaching, threatening to derail the futures of some of this country's brightest young minds. But of course, the process has not been linear, as you know. And so in December, just a few months ago, the Supreme Court remanded five of the DACA cases back to the Ninth Circuit. In other words, allowed the Trump team not to send renewal documents to the DACA plaintiffs, which was a very disappointing move. Meanwhile, this year, on January 9th, the District Court for Northern California temporarily blocked the decision of DACA, ordering the government to renew DACA. And on the 13th of January, the government said that it would resume approving DACA applications. So, so much for this kind of judicial back and forth and the seesawing and this kind of, you know, constantly changing target. What about the legislature? So In September and November 2017, as we know, this is where we got the kind of title for today's talk, short-term government spending bills were jeopardized by tensions over DACA, a real first as far as I know. In fact, as we all know, the government shut down for nearly 2 days, unprecedented, because of this issue of child migration. I don't know of any other case where a government has been shut down over this issue, which, as I say, 10 years ago, people just used to say to me, what, you work on child migration, is that even a topic? You know, and here we have the US government being shut down. So, dramatic move. And again, Nancy Pelosi said, we're not going to leave here without the DREAM Act passing, without a DACA fix. In fact, we know both spending bills eventually pass without any resolution on DACA. And then, in January 2018, President Trump, the would-be dealmaker, tweeted that he would not accept a DACA deal without appropriations for the border wall. And in a televised meeting, that famous meeting on January 16th, the meeting in which he regretted the low levels of immigration from Norway and the high levels of immigration from shithole countries, in that same meeting he intimated that separate DACA negotiations would take place. But, of course, this deal hadn't really been thought through, it hadn't been negotiated with his own party, and so it was rebuffed by Senate Republicans. Another kind of really irresponsible move, it seems to me. And then on January 20th, as I said, DACA closed down the government for a short while, so much so that then the Republicans provided assurances that there would be some discussion. So that was the concession, that was the way the kind of political bargain worked out. And this again is unusual. All of this, I guess, is unusual, to actually have a discussion on the floor of the House, an open-ended discussion. And then, as we all know, just a week ago, Nancy Pelosi made the longest speech in House history, giving 8 hours of testimony from the Dreamers, an amazing kind of use of her position, I think, and a very powerful kind of piece of political advocacy. And so now we're in the situation of this unusual kind of free-for-all debate about DACA and other immigration issues in the Senate. So a debate that's open-ended, there can be, as I understand it, an unlimited number of amendments, but whatever solution is eventually arrived at will need to have bipartisan support, and that is the challenge. Trump has said there's a good chance of getting a deal on DACA if the Democrats are serious. Meanwhile, from the House Republicans, there's no sign of any commitment to consider a bill, even if the Senate does pass one. And of course, Trump has to sign off. So I think my takeaway, and it'd be interesting to hear what all of you think, my takeaway is that there's a lot of talk. Of course, we still have no resolution, and the ambivalence that I talked about in the beginning really, I think, still characterizes this. So Trump hasn't kind of given up on the Dreamers in a way. He hasn't said, well, you know, these are people who are illegal and Kenya should, you know, go back to where they come from. He's not said that. But neither has he really been willing to sacrifice any political mileage or really make a statement that really pushed, I think, the needle. So I want to now just switch a little bit to talk back about Europe and to highlight the parallels, because we often think of the enormous difference between the US situation and the European situation. I certainly often do. But actually the parallels in a way now, I think, are quite striking. So the same kind of tension between, on the one hand, the heartaches and the sense of wasted lives and opportunities, and on the other hand, this sort of resurgent nativism, which has so much political capital and which politicians are using and building. So as I indicated a few minutes ago, the European Union has now reinforced and reinstated the Dublin Agreement. That's the agreement which says that anybody entering the European Union has to be dealt with by the country which they first enter. So if you are coming from Turkey or from Libya and your first point of entry into the EU is Greece or Italy, which is likely to be the case because people from Syria are if your first point of entry is, say, Greece or Italy, then that's the country that has to consider your application. And that's what was kind of put to one side in the summer of 2015 after, you know, the Elancourt image was published. So that's now back in force. And so asylum seekers are not getting through to Germany legally, they're not getting through to Sweden, they're not getting through anywhere in Northern or Western Europe. They're really stuck. If they're even getting to Europe, they're getting stuck at the southern border. And so what do we see? Just like we see large numbers of children and families detained here, of course being blocked by Mexico, but those who managed to make it in being detained in Texas. So we see in Europe shelters, detention camps really, on the Greek islands, extraordinarily poor conditions of detention, extraordinary for the European Union. I mean, they would be execrable anywhere. But in, you know, the richest continent in the world, to have these detention facilities where overcrowding is so acute and safety is so minimal that really children and women's lives are constantly in the balance. This is really harsh, and our center has done a study recently in the Greek detention facilities, and we've highlighted some of the problems. They're just the kind of fact that there are no, you know, officials around in the evening or at night, and so, you know, people are coming and going in other people's kind of tents or in other people's dwellings. The fact that the overcrowding is so dramatic that there are health concerns now, you know, talking about Europe and so on. Lack of access to adequate education or kind of anything but emergency healthcare. So really a very dramatic shortfall in rights protection. Not so different from the situation that we see here in the US. So kind of a disturbing but interesting parallel. Secondly, we see this threat of removal and lack of exercise of kind of concessions or legal enforcement also in Europe. So in Sweden, for example, which has been one of the countries who have the best record of asylum seekers and refugees, and have actually accepted the largest number of unaccompanied minors in Europe, 35,000, which is a huge number if you think about it from kind of a country like Sweden. They're now not only refusing family reunification, but they actually been trying to remove kids who they say don't qualify for asylum. And so we recently saw a sit-in in a central square in Stockholm of unaccompanied Afghan teenagers protesting being sent back to what they said was a threat of being reduced by the Taliban in Afghanistan. And anybody who knows anything about Afghanistan knows that it's not a safe country. And it's not a safe country, particularly for adolescent boys. So for Sweden to be sending children back, claiming that they don't have a right to refugee protection, is disturbing. Fortunately, this kind of well supported by the Swedish population demonstration and sit-in actually resulted in the concession. So as I say, discretion sometimes works in favor of kids' rights. And so this cohort of Afghan kids actually have now been granted permission, temporary permission to stay in Stockholm. I know, we don't know for how long. And maybe there will be similar moves in the US. So I think this kind of sense of precarity and the vulnerability that comes with a status which is not legally enshrined is one of the things that we're seeing in these different continents, a lack of acknowledgement that these child migrants, child refugees, child residents have legal rights. This, I think, is the most concerning factor. But I don't want to just only sound this kind of note of doom and gloom, though the times certainly are very dark, because I do think there are important opportunities ahead, and I do think there is enormous scope for advocacy at all levels, kind of legal advocacy in the courts, political advocacy, you know, in Parliament or in Congress, and then most important, citizen advocacy, wherever it's possible. And why do I say this? I say this for several reasons. If you think about the UN level or the global level, there are very interesting, encouraging moves afoot. For the first time ever, migration is now a part of the development agenda. Some of you may be aware of the Millennial Development Goals, the MDGs, which have now been superseded by the Sustainable Development Goals, or SDGs. So we're now in phase two, the SDGs, which span the next 15 years, from 2015 to 2030. And what the SDGs do is they set an agenda for benchmarking progress on key development goals. And it's a very useful device for trying to move the needle, trying to get states to focus on certain priorities, putting resources into monitoring how states are doing, prioritizing funding from philanthropic organizations and USAID and Swedish aid and Canadian aid and so on, certain goals. So you're really trying to have an organized approach to development improvements across the board. And for the first time ever, migration is part of this agenda. And as somebody's worked for most of my working life on migration, I can't tell you how significant that is. Because there are many global issues which obviously need interstate collaboration. You only have to think of climate change, or inequality, or poverty, or transnational crime. And all of those other issues have been the subject of international treaties, they've been the subject of UN collaboration. But migration never has, because states have always said migration, controlling the borders, is a sovereign prerogative. We decide which non-citizens we let in. Nobody else can tell us what to do. That's been the mantra forever. And of course, there are some regional exceptions. The EU is one. NAFTA was not one, but we have Mercosur. We have other regional agreements which have partly attenuated them. But at the global or UN level, there's never before been any concession that migration should be a concern of the United Nations. And that has changed. It's changed, of course, because of what happened in Europe. Not that there haven't been mass migrations in Africa, mass migrations in Asia, but this kind of spectrum of people just kind of flooding in across the Middle East and Turkey into kind of Eastern Europe and across the continent changed the dynamic. And so we have SDG, Sustainable Development Goal 10-7, this is kind of the Sustainable Development Goal number 10 and target number 7, which calls for safe, legal and regular migration for all. So there's a kind of commitment to enabling mobility. Migration is no longer categorized with drug smuggling and currency smuggling and international arms dealing as a transnational crime, which is where it's really being thought of. It's thought of as something positive, as something which is a right for all people, not just for rich people or educated people. A hugely significant move. And in that rubric of SDG 10-7, there's a lot of movement. So again, some of you may know that as a result of that SDG commitment and as a result of the concern about international migration, in September 2016, the United Nations General Assembly held a high-level meeting, as they call it, heads of state, so pretty high-level, I guess, discussing migration and refugee issues. And they decided to craft two new global compacts, so-called, one on migration and one on refugees. The idea was that in the next 2 years, between September 2016 and 2018, the UN is going to, the states' parties, members of the United Nations, are going to craft two new global compacts, i.e., they're going to really think concretely about how to improve the management of international migration. So there's a lot to say about both the refugee compact and the migration compact, but I just want to focus on the migration compact because that's really what concerns those who are undocumented. What the migration compact is working towards is a situation where residents and the facts of mobility are taken into account as positive factors which can underpin rights. So some of us have been working on child migration and on lobbying on the need to have greater access to safe, legal and regular migration for children, because actually I think that children are discriminated against and have much less access to safe, legal and regular migration than adults, paradoxically. We talk about wanting to protect children and the need that children have for security and permanency, but in fact, it's very hard for children, unless they're traveling with families, or unless they come from wealthy families who can afford to send them abroad for education or something. Children and adolescents, and young people for that matter, really don't have access to work permits, to apprenticeships, to skill training, to access to higher education, to any of the kind of tools that many privileged families think are actually critical for their kids. There's a real kind of economic apartheid. And so the work that some of us have done, where I insist that this is not just a dark moment, but also a moment of opportunity, the work that some of us have done is to think through what these global compacts should mean for children and young people, the next generation. And so a group of us have drafted some instruments which are now being used to lobby and are actually really getting countries, member states, to sign on to. So Mexico and Switzerland are leading the discussion of the Global Compact on Migration. And I was just at a meeting last Friday in New York, where we had the two ambassadors, and we had the representative of the Secretary General, Luis Arbor, who is running this process, really talking about how we can develop agreements and get countries to sign on and actually commit to improving access to legal and safe migration for different constituencies. How residence should be an important factor. How belonging, how family unity, how creation of aspirations for the future should be able to ground some form of legal rights. So I really want to conclude by saying that I think that harsh and in some ways terrifying though this moment is, it really is also a moment where activism has never been more important, because there is a discussion on the table. It's not as if we're banging against a completely closed brick wall. Once you have, you know, all the heads of state agreeing that migration needs better management, once you have a general commitment that migration is a positive force, that it can create opportunity and win-win solutions for both, then it is also a moment in which some of the darker sides, like this kind of criminalization of undocumented populations, can be addressed. And so I really hope that all of us can be part of kind of moving the needle to a better place than we seem to be at now.
Effects in the wrong direction. So I can't really answer that. I don't know. Do
you want to say something? What's your sense about the impact of Pelosi's speech?
You know, I think that this is an issue that 2007, so just a little over 10 years ago, a DREAM Act bill was attached to potential big education bill, a defense bill, and none of those passed, and then it was released as a standalone and had no traction at all because it just didn't have traction. It wasn't an issue that people cared about passionately. Fast forward 11 years, and everybody in this country knows what this is. Everybody in this country knows what a quote-unquote dreamer is. It's a household issue. So I think that, you know, the extent to which Nancy Pelosi for 8 hours and whatever was reported her 4-inch high heels on the floor, using that time to talk about DACA beneficiaries. You know, these stories are limited and limiting, to be sure, reinforcing very particular stories and scripts about who these people are, but nevertheless very impressive. I agree.
What do you think? Are you skeptical?
I am skeptical. I'm from Texas. I'm just visiting.
Oh, you're from Texas. I was Texas.
Some of my friends are involved with United We Dream, and I think there's a lot of concern that people, our politicians, even progressive politicians, will say one thing, but then when it comes down to votes, when it comes down to making trade-offs, that people don't follow through. Some people in Texas are still unaware of the process dreamers go through. So I don't know. I come from a very different state.
I think that there are people here. I'll shut up. I think there are people here who share that sentiment. I don't know. It's Texas. Dick Durbin was here last week, and he got hell. He got hell from students.
Yeah, I think it is important to point out that Nancy Pelosi, she encouraged her Democratic, members to vote for the very bill that it seemed as if she was protesting, because she did believe that there are very good things in this bill for their constituents. And so it does begin to seem like this was a show to say, we did something, even though that something was not as substantive as what she knew it was going to be. I think it's kind of problematic for you to be staging what seems like a protest, but then telling your members to vote for that thing that you are kind of protesting.
Oh. Thank you. Always great to hear you, Jackie. I'm wondering about thoughts of individual rights versus families. Even 10 years ago, when there were raids in the southern part of our state, there was media and political choice to focus on the mothers and the children being separated and so forth. And the fact is, in many fields, I'm a lawyer, and our Constitution is based a lot on individual rights, but in healthcare, for instance, there's a more focus on families and not so much just individual decision making, but that people live in families and communities. And that was also used as a political strategy to fight these raids in the past, these people that are part of our communities. But I'm wondering where this migration compact is going. Is it a focus on an individual, be it an adult or a child, however the age is defined, or sort of broader in terms of right to be with your family, either here or there?
Well, so the Migration Compact does many things. thing. I mean, there have been several documents. There's the Secretary General put out a comment on the Migration Compact 2 weeks ago, which was actually a very progressive document. And then there's now the so-called zero draft, kind of UN speak, which is the first take of the states' parties on what should be in the Global Compact on Migration, which is what we were discussing on Friday. And there are many things that are in there, so there's definitely an acknowledgement of individual rights and talking about, you know, I mean, one of the most basic, I think, is the rights that come with residence, and I think that's actually, with residence, so I think that that is a huge issue, which actually it doesn't get much traction in the US, but it seems to me that if someone has lived, it's a bit like the same issue of estoppel. If the state hasn't deported you for 10 years, in a way they should be estoppel. They've kind of led you to believe that you can stay.
Yeah.
You know, if you're going to deport somebody, well, you know, get on with it. They arrive, they're undocumented. If you really kind of, if they're so harmful, they're so dangerous to the state, well then, you know, you give people notice, you have a hearing, and that's it. But if you kind of lull people into this sense of, you know, confidence, you let somebody spend 30 years in a country, you let them have their whole life in a country or their whole other life, you should be prevented then from changing tack. It's a kind of a, it's again a sense of deceit. So, and many countries have this base, this notion that you can have various avenues to legal status, one of which comes from residence. So, I mean, autobiographical here. When I was practicing in the UK, and I think the law hasn't changed much since then, if somebody had been legally resident in a temporary capacity for 10 years, then they could apply for permanent residence. So say you have one of those kind of indefinite students, you know, who come, got a graduate degree, a master's degree, a PhD, take forever to finish their PhD, but they're always in status. At the end of 10 years, if you hadn't spent more than 3 months abroad in any given year, you could apply for either way. If you were undocumented, you could do that after 14 years. So all you have to do is to show that you had, again, been present. So you have to, of course, it's not always easy, but you have to show electricity bills or, you know, that you've been in school or doctor's notes or something. But we did that in many cases. And unless you had a criminal record, the kind of notion was, it was a discretion, but it was always exercised in the resident's favor. You've been resident somewhere for 14 years, you know, if the government let you stay for 14 years. So that's one element. Now that goes to the individual rights stuff, but the global, and many other issues related to that, so that you should be able to have a fair trial, you should be able to have legal representation, you should be able to, you know, there's a lot in there about moving from the situation of having most blue-collar and manual jobs being done by people who are undocumented or irregular or informal to people who are, you know, formally recognized as contributing to the economy. There's also a large section in there, of course, on kind of communities, family reunification, the sense of kind of the diversity, growing diversity of our global situation. So it's multiple. But, you know, I think I would slightly not disagree with you, but I do think the emphasis on rights, individual rights, is very important. You know, discretion only takes you so far. And not everybody has a family. In fact, most of the unaccompanied kids that we are dealing with, actually, their family is back home, or they are estranged from their family because of abuse, or, you know, war or conflict. And so many young people who are migrating are actually leaving desperate situations. They don't really have a family or a community, and they still should have the right to establish that and to have access to. So my emphasis has really been on young people's rights to have a rewarding future. And this is where I think the win-win comes in, that when we have this very dramatically shifting demographic map with sub-Saharan Africa kind of swooping up, and most other parts of the world kind of gradually going down, and East Asia dropping down kind of off the cliff in terms of demographic growth, and all the kind of institutions of kind of most, the overwhelming majority of institutions of secondary and higher education are in these places where the population is sort of going down. It's a no-brainer to think that of course there should be much more flow, and there should be a kind of what you have in Europe, this Erasmus program. You should have that globally. There should be a sense of accessibility. And of course, we should also be doing this much more here. We should be doing this much more virtually, too, so that we really are building global classrooms rather than just having our own kind of physically homogeneous classrooms. So I think it's a mixture of all those things. But I would be happy to share with, you know, with you guys these little compacts. They're not long, and they make for really interesting reading. And of course, they're going to be amended. At the moment, they're pretty blue sky. They're pretty, you know, written by people like me, so they have a lot in there which will not survive the kind of hard-nosed scrutiny of senior civil servants. But I think they are an interesting starting point, and they give an idea of how you can really reframe the migration discussion to see it as an asset, as a global asset.
Thank you so much for this. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about the role of intermediary states like Libya, as you laid it out, and like Mexico. From the perspective of Guatemala, where I lived for some time, the dreamers are those who made it. They made it to the United States, passing through what's becoming an increasingly fragile territory of Mexico. So it's sort of ironic from that perspective to hear that Mexico is playing a leading role in the impact on migration, whereas they're seen as some of the primary perpetrators as being the United States is advance guard and deporting kids that have a chance to
really
make
fascinating.
It. So it's, just like what policy possibilities can be or are being used to pressure Mexico takes up on some of their most.
Yeah, okay. So I mean, just to say a little bit about what's happening in Mexico. So Mexico is a fascinating case study at the moment because Mexico is the de facto barrier. And so there are now up to 1 million undocumented migrants in Mexico City alone. And we are working very closely with colleagues in Mexico City on a project looking at the relationship between organized crime and undocumented migrants, which unfortunately is really close. Because as you can imagine, all these people who are trapped there, just like people are trapped in Libya or in Greece, you know, they didn't want to end up in Mexico, of course, don't have many prospects. And so one of the reasons why organized crime is an attractive kind of fellow traveler is because it's a source of potential income, or at least they think it's a source of potential income. You know, you have to pay coyotes, you have to get across the border. How are you going to do that? You have to work. How are you going to get a job? You're undocumented in Mexico, so this is the kind of best business in town. And so what our colleague is documenting is this real growth in the kind of focus by, I mean, he said that there are 250 drug cartels in Mexico. This is my colleague Sergio Aguayo, who's kind of a leading Mexican sociologist. Who you probably know as well. So Sergio says that there are, these cartels are now really, really focusing on migrants, and particularly, of course, undocumented migrants are absolutely, you know, sort of sitting there. So what's happening is that many of the kids are being recruited this way, to mule, to be just kind of dealing, I mean, even just in Mexico, forget the border, they're getting paid to kind of be part of the kind of criminal activities of the gang. And of course, Mexico has its own very intense problems. I mean, it's become the epicenter of the drug trade, moved away from Colombia. So even the Colombian kind of chiefs are now basically working out of Mexico City. So that's what's happened. In terms of the public role, it's very interesting. I imagine that there is a big divide in the Mexican government between the Ministry of Interior and the Foreign Service people, like the Department of State, the State Department. Because every time I go to any of these migration conferences, among the most articulate and the most progressive and the best informed are the Mexican. The ambassador, who's the kind of Mexico's ambassador to the UN, who I met on Friday, I mean, he could not have been more engaged with this issue. I mean, he and the Swiss ambassador are the co-chairs, but he's effectively the kind of greatest behind it. I mean, he's really very invested. So I think Mexico, of course, migration is a huge issue for Mexico as a settling country, but it's also become a huge issue in other ways. So I think for them, trying to get some sort of deal on how you sort out this growing problem. But as you rightly point out, Mexico is, I mean, what's happening at the southern border with Guatemala, as you probably know, is really concerning. And the detention facilities there, which are overflowing, and again, it's a bit like the situation in Libya. You have like a factor of 10 to 1 overcrowding in the jails in the southern border between Mexico and Guatemala. I was speaking to the senior person at UNHCR the other day who visited this. Know the murder capitals of the world, you know, Honduras, El Salvador, Guatemala, maybe third, but certainly Honduras and El Salvador are really places from which people would have clearly well-founded fear of persecution, should be eligible for asylum and should be involved. So it's interesting, it would be an interesting study in kind of, you know, in political kind of, you know, it just shows you really can't have a homogenized view of government or the state, because I imagine the state in the case of Mexico is very, very, very diversified and very disaggregated, just like we've seen that, you know, in the US with kind of, you know, issue of slavery. I mean, there are very different positions in kind of State Department seen slavery or Jim Crow as being a terrible legacy for the US globally, and yet internally, you know, many forces of government defending those kind of acts. So I think it's a complex situation, but, you know, it is interesting that Mexico decided to be co-chair of this process. It does say a lot about how serious the issue is. But did you get that?
Yeah, I did. There's a Supreme Court decision that says Filer versus Doe, that says every child undocumented is entitled to a public education. At this point, it's not the dreamers because they do have, to go to education. But when families are undocumented and their children are afraid to go to school because they may you know, be a source of where the parents can also be deported, I'm concerned about the fact that so many undocumented children, not the dreamers, are not having an education. And I wonder if in the detention centers, is there any kind of education, or are they just imprisoned there? What is the situation?
No, I mean, I think Roberta knows much more about this than I do, but maybe I'll just give a first crack at an answer. So, I mean, I think you're all probably familiar with the Supreme Court decision that was just referenced. It's a kind of a very important Supreme Court decision, which has not been reversed, which says that every child has a right to free primary education in the US irrespective of their immigration status, which is not the situation in every European country, so it was a very important decision. But of course, as you point out, because immigrant families, I think rightly, are frightened that there isn't a real firewall between education authorities and law enforcement authorities and immigration authorities, there are cases, I don't know the numbers, and maybe you know how many families are pulling kids out or not having kids go, but we certainly know, I know from colleagues locally working in the health services, and they're concerned that kids are not coming to health clinics because families are frightened of any engagement or any interaction with you know, official bodies. And so I'm sure that's having a knock-on effect, but I don't know the details. I think it has been, you know, one of the real strong points that schools have really insisted on the rights of all kids to present. But again, I'm sure it varies from state to state, and I don't know. Do you know about that?
I think it does vary. Lip service to, sorry, to having, you know, schools be safe places, but without, like, there's a bill in Massachusetts to have a Secure Communities Act, and it hasn't been passed, but that's one of the issues. But with Plyer v. Doe, sadly, the U.S. government is providing the right inside family detention centers. You know, kids are not going out to the public schools when
that's
they're detained
say,
with their families.
In terms of the second part of your question, they are getting something called education, but I gather it's really minimal. But what do you think about that?
No, I think that's right. other part of the other aspect of this is that, that there are, in certain counties, school districts are trying to deny kids. And we've seen this in growing numbers.
Deny kids access to schools?
Access to schools, yeah. We've seen this in growing numbers.
They're not adhering to the Iowa.
Yes, that's right.
And I know a young woman who came from Brazil or some country, and her mother was here, but she came after about 12 years. And she tried to enroll in schools in Pennsylvania, around Philadelphia, and a couple of them basically wouldn't allow her to come unless she said where she was living and had some other documentation. And finally, she had to go, I recommend that she go with the Center for Education Law, where they do a lot of immigration stuff, and they were able to, you know, get her a,
That's very concerning. It's extremely concerning to see this kind of happening. Yeah. I'm sure with this climate at the moment, it's very understandable that families would feel, terrified, I suppose.
Other questions?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's kind of along the lines of that question. Because I know there's FERPA, right? And it protects people, or it protects ICE agents or other people from accessing the information that the schools have. But I'm wondering how challenging is that for the agencies to find a warrant, which is what they need to have the information, and then access the schools and whether it's doing.
How easy is it for immigration enforcement to get access to the inside the schools? I don't know
the
answer.
To a warrant.
To get
so
a warrant, to get access to
FERPA.
Yeah. I don't know the answer to that question.
I don't know that either, but I do know when I worked in state government, or when the Immigration Reform and Control Act was passed in the 80s, early 90s, immigration agents came to the Department of Public Health, state office building, to arrest an undocumented employee who was an independent contractor, and then asked for information on all the employees in that unit, and we found the warrant defective and advised not turning over that information. So, you know, we're after consulting with me and the Attorney General's office, they didn't give it over. But with FERPA, there's another wrinkle, which FERPA, it protects a lot of your school information, but FERPA authorizes the release of what they call directory information without consent. So that's like name and address and phone number. It's not not your immigration status, and I don't know, like in the Boston Public Schools, they say they're not collecting immigration status, but, you know, it's an issue. You know, and it depends on, generally, it sometimes depends on the courage of the government officials, because they'll consult lawyers, and if there's like a valid judicial warrant, not like a administrative warrant, you know, they may say, look, you know, there's legal compulsion to turn this over. Are you willing to risk contempt or not? You know, and then it's up to judges. But recently, you may have read in the newspaper that Patty Saris, who's on the federal courts, you know, really looked at this like we're not turning people away like we did in, you know, World War II, not sending people back in their rights here. So,
Other questions?
Thank you for your talk, Joseph. So I'm taking an immigration class now, and one of the arguments that comes up again and again
that I found very convincing. But I was wondering what you think is the most persuasive legal argument out there being waged in favor of the Dreamers that has some real possibility of success or that's convincing.
Yeah, well, it's interesting. I certainly think that point that, you know, often the children did not make the decision is an interesting one. They didn't have the agency at the time, because they were, you know, very, very young. So I think you need to be under 15 if I'm not, is that right? Let me just check, I wrote down complications. You need to have arrived before the age of...
16.
Before turning 16, must have arrived in the US before turning 16. So, you know, for some, if you're 2 or 3, it's one thing. If you're 14, 15, 16, I think the argument is harder. And then all the issues about consent, I think, are always complicated. So, I mean, you know, who does consent, who doesn't consent, you know. Personally, I mean, that's fine. If people want to advance that argument, that's fine. I wouldn't advance that argument. I think the argument about residence is much stronger. I think that if you have allowed people to stay and settle and have a life somewhere, then you have an obligation to respect their right to family life, their right to private life, their right to a home. So that, you know, that if you think of the DACA recipients, their whole private life is here. You know, I mean, and because they are undocumented, they haven't gone back and forth to wherever, because they haven't left the country, because they wouldn't be able to get back again. So they've been here their whole adult life and most of their childhood. So their friends, their language, TV programs they watch, the food they use, the weather, I mean, everything is here. So that, I think, is the strongest argument. Whether somebody did or didn't consent, sure, you can make that claim. But I'm not keen on that argument also, because then it divides the DACA recipients from all the other undocumented. And in a way, it's, you know, of course, you have to fight legal battles and political battles as they come up. And so this now is the forefront, and of course we have to go all out with every argument that will protect this cohort. But actually, what about all the other 11 million people who also have a right to be here? So if we push so much just on the failure to consent, we're kind of saying, well, all these other people who've also lived here for most of their life, they consented, so they're disqualified. So for both substantive and pragmatic reasons, I prefer an argument that really goes to the substance of the human right, which is the human right to respect for your family and your private life. Unfortunately, in the US, we don't have any such human rights oversight, international human rights oversight, as you know from my class. But in Europe, we do. In many other countries in Africa, you would. So this would be the way that sort of argument would be framed. So that's what I think. Now, how powerful that would be before the Supreme Court, I don't know. I mean, it probably wouldn't be. And I'm sure with the Supreme Court, you know, they will be very much looking over their shoulder at all the other 11 or 12 million undocumented people in this country to try to make a wedge. So pragmatically, it might not be the best argument, the one I'm thinking. Yeah.
Hi, thank you so much for this really wonderful discussion, and I really appreciated the comparative lens. I think it's so important to think of U.S. policy sort of in this global immigration context. And I mean, two things strike me when we think about this immigration debate in the U.S., and I wonder if it's the same elsewhere. The first is, of course, as you've been talking about, the criminalization of immigrants, right, including DACA recipients, although they become sort of the model immigrants. But they're still, in many ways, criminalized simply because they broke their legal status. The other is that people, particularly in the U.S., really don't understand the basics of immigration policy. And I'm saying the very basics. So I'll share personal, I'm a former DACA recipient. I have since, thankfully, by some complicated mechanism, because I'm a green card holder now. But for many years, I was undocumented in this country. I came to the U.S. when I was 14 years old. So your argument about the power of the residency claim, and I think that's right on target. But the most common question I would get when I would share that, and I couldn't share it often, was, why didn't you become legal? I mean, why don't you legalize your status? That's the most consistent response. And sure, you know, having had to explain that, you know, well, there's really no path for legalization for until, you know, DACA gives some relief, right? But not a path. I didn't get a green card because of the DACA. So I think those are the two things, and you concluded talking about advocacy, right, at all levels. And I wonder if in other places there are some advocacy examples that we can learn from that have been successful, either on the criminalization or the just, I guess, education level, broadly speaking, or any other aspects of advocacy. Because I think at the end of the day, that's where it's going to come from.
We don't have a whole lot of time, yeah. So maybe I'll take a couple of questions, yeah. And then so sure. I don't have to say too long. So were there any other questions? So I'll start.
Sure,
yeah.
Thanks.
So this is sort of,
you know what, I'm just going to grab a pen. So
yeah, go ahead.
I'm wondering if there are any ideas that you have about strategies to improve conditions in detention centers, and I know that's sort of like addressing a sort of a band-aid response rather than wanting to just try to address the root problem, but it does seem like such a severe place where human rights are being violated currently in detention centers. And hearing you talk about, you know, I'm familiar with private corporations in the US, but hearing you talk about ways that detention centers get controlled by different entities in different countries, something that I hadn't thought about before. So if there's wondering if maybe linked to the Sustainable Development Goals or any legal advocacy efforts to have a concerted strategy for reducing the rights violations that occur in detention centers.
Yeah.
And the US, I mean, have a huge problem with that.
Can you explain to me the difference between the government letting you stay for XYZ amount of years versus you have been able to evade detection, and how those things might not be the same, and how to make sense of that, right? So if you have used someone else's social security number, if you have, you know, done all these things, that's different than the government like saying that you could work, saying that you can do all these things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Good question.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe a little picture, but with all the kind of rhetoric that goes back and forth from the top down, from like, you know, what's what you're speaking about with Trump previously, and also with the very, I guess, the range of different positions that are taking place in courts and the battles that continue to go on, and some things are allowed, some things are disallowed, and goes back and forth. Are you fearful of in general, courts being dismissed and the judiciary system in America being dismissed, are you fearful of just like this becoming an extrajudicial matter where ICE will continue to do something regardless of what's taking place in the courts?
Yeah, okay, well, maybe I'll just stop there for the start and then we can maybe take one more round. So, the first question about advocacy strategies. Over the years, I think the civil rights movement, if you like, have scored several important victories cumulatively, not so much on prevention of deportation of undocumented populations, but on recognition of a basis for staying. So it's kind of like, you know, slightly a fine line. So there have been many deportation campaigns and deportation activists who have succeeded in preventing removal of individuals or families because of community links and huge pressure and so on. So I think, you know, I can't say this enough, and I'm sure in this room it's common knowledge, but that community mobilization is so important. You know, governments don't like ripping people out when there's a big demonstration outside. It's much easier to go and nobody's paying attention. You just take somebody, you put them on a friend. But the moment there are people and there are planners and the press is there and you're kind of, you know, this nice family who everybody loves, I mean, they don't like that. And so it makes it much harder for them. Not that they don't do it, but they don't like it. So that's at one level. Secondly, certainly in my field, which is children and young people, we've made quite a lot of strides advocacy-wise in some areas, like insisting, this is much more in Europe than here, insisting on legal representation, paid legal representation, insisting on guardianship, basically getting rid of detention generally, compulsory detention, making a lot of progress on age determination. It's a bit technical, but one of the big issues with children is, you know, how old is somebody? Most, and many, many people don't have birth certificates, or they don't have birth certificates which are credible. And so then there are all these tests that governments use to ascertain whether somebody is below or, under, below or over 18. And so we've made a lot of progress on moving away from these one-dimensional tests to more complicated strategies. So there have been successes. It's always a balance. The European Court of Human Rights has delivered some very good judgments on the right to respect for family life, on the importance of asylum, and so on. So yes, advocacy, it's a kind of a tangle, I would say. But of course, now we're in this phase where whatever the advocacy victories, I feel the pendulum has swung, you know, to this much more nativist, populist agenda. And so we have a huge amount of work ahead of us. Somebody asked a question about detention. I forget who it was. Yeah. So that's been one of the main focuses of advocacy, actually. And in the child migrant context, we've made a lot of progress. It's one of the things that's in the Global Compact on Migration is to end detention for children. And in many European countries, if it's undisputed that someone is a child, they will not normally be detained. Now, the Greek situation, they call them shelters, and so, and they're not actually under lock and key, but in practice, they've got nowhere else to go, so it is a form of detention. But actually, the idea of, like we have in America, where states kind of still routinely lock up mothers and young children, that does not happen in Europe anymore. So there has been progress. There's a very, very active, capable detention, immigrant detention coalition, anti-detention coalition, which has been very effective, very good lawyers, very good advocacy. And so it's one of the strongest, actually, elements, I would say, in the immigrant rights and advocacy movement. And so they've made a lot of progress. And you see that reflected in these global compacts, too, the move away from criminalization, the notion that it's, you know, really unconscionable to put people who have already escaped detention in their own countries as political prisoners, whatever, put them back in detention. But again, there's a long way to go. We still have, every year, people committed suicide, asylum seekers committing suicide in prison, in detention center every year. So there is a long way to go. But, you know, if you're interested, I mean, that's a great campaign. And they do very good work. They do very good briefings. They're very organized. They're multiple levels. So it's a very good question. You know, I said that if the government has let you stay for 14 years, you know, they should be stopped from deporting you. And somebody might say, well, they haven't let you stay, you've just hidden and they haven't found you. But I think that it's clear from even how deportation policy has evolved in this country that where the government wants to deport people, wants to target people, it can quite effectively do that. And I would refer you to my colleague Dan Canstrom, who is a professor at the law school at Boston College, who's written a book called Deportation Nation, which I would say is a must for anybody who's interested in US immigration policy. So Canstrom is K-A-N-S-T-R-O-O-M. And what Dan shows is how, when you decide you're going to target criminal, so-called criminal aliens, so aliens who may be lawful, who may be permanent residents, but they couldn't look, you know, the government has gone after them in millions of people. So it isn't, you know, governments do find people. I mean, I'm not persuaded by the argument that this is a weak government that doesn't know where people are. Clearly there's a lot of complicity. You know, I mean, people always say New York would shut down tomorrow if every undocumented worker was removed. I mean, we depend on the undocumented workers for so much. So I think it is fair to say that there is complicity, that the government knows that it's not just that people have been kind of hiding in the basement. People have been giving their lives, and government has sort of been accepted that this is the way things are run, and actually that it's convenient to have people who are undocumented who are more vulnerable and more exposed to them anyways. Now, I can see, though, that, you know, that argument is not the strongest, but I think when you haven't bothered to find people for a long time, I'm not saying like after a year or two, you should say, well, you let me in and you haven't done anything about it, so I agree with you. But after, say, 10 years, I would say then the onus is on the government to say why they haven't done something about this. If having somebody in a country is so onerous, also, you know, dangerous, also costly, then why hasn't more effort been made? If you let somebody stay for 10 years, they've built up a whole life, it's too late to then turn around. That's how I would make that argument. So I wouldn't be defensive about that. I would say that the onus is on government to act fairly promptly. But if you let people stay for 10 years, they should have a right to residence. Unless they've committed an offence or they haven't, you know, they've done something, you know, which is, does create a security in some situations. That's at least how I would argue that. Extrajudicial activity by ICE. I mean, clearly we saw that in the early days of this administration. We saw immigration officers, border patrol people, you know, just like unleashing racism at a rate of knots, which is unprecedented, feeling that they had a green light. And we saw that in that very confusing period, you know, when the Trump's executive orders were promulgated. We saw people just being sent back and escaped. So there is a danger when you have a political green light like there is at the moment. You can certainly see some of the agencies taking advantage, and I think many, not all, but many of these agencies, of course, are going to have employees within them who've been waiting for this moment. But for better or for worse, you know, the rule of law still does actually work pretty well. Not that there aren't communities that are not being terrorized, there are. But I think that if, and I'm very concerned about the Supreme Court, of course, as anybody should be, and going forward, you know, several fairly elderly members of the Supreme Court, who may well stand out during this administration. I mean, it's a terrifying prospect. But I do think that I wouldn't be too alarmist about the fact that ICE is just going to take over. That said, of course, there are communities where they do, and we see this every day, and some of my colleagues are writing pieces where they feel that this is kind of creeping fascism, you know, whether that's appropriate language or not, I'm not sure, but there's certainly some examples in some states where, you know, where things are very, 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 very concerning, and where, and we see this in Europe too, I mean, wherever you have a political car base which marks its open natives and xenophobia and administrative officials who are that maybe we'll make this the last question.
This relates to temporary resident status.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them have come at different points. For instance, now I'm very concerned about patients.
Yeah.
You know, like they don't have the support down in Haiti. But they are children. There are children among them. And I'm just curious about many of these people have had a long, productive career here,
yep.
And then they're being deported by, you know, the country from which they came.
Yep.
And I'm just curious about what you think can be done about that.
So I noticed that there's a whole seminar on TPS, which is great. It's a huge issue, an absolutely huge issue. I think that two things can be done. One is that many of these TPS, temporary protected status recipients, will be eligible for some other form of relief. Many of them may have a well-founded fear of persecution, so they may be able to make asylum claims, which they didn't need to make because they had TPS before. Some may have other kind of family bases or may be able to get some kind of employment basis, but many people will be at risk. And I think it's a very, again, my argument would rely on residents. I think there's also another danger, which is a kind of obverse of the shithole country approach, if you'll excuse my language, which is that we don't want to just say, well, these countries are basket cases, you can't send people back to them. you know, that's not a legitimate argument. I think we have to always talk about individual lives and how we can establish their life here. It's not that, you know, Haiti is a country where no reasonable person would want to live. That's not the sort of argument you want to make. And I think there's sometimes a danger that people are in their eagerness to kind of, you know, advocate for their clients or for their community members, you're saying, well, you know, can't send somebody back to Haiti. You know, that begins to sound very much like President Trump. And so I think we have to think about, you know, the circumstances. These are people who have lived here for a long time. Some of them may have asylum claims, or they may not have asylum claims. But again, the government has given them, has held itself out. You've built a life, you've built a future, you've had children, you've built your family. What is the benefit? What is the ethical, moral argument the government has for turning back on itself? What is the harm that you're doing? What is the cost that you are kind of imposing on this society? I mean, those are the sorts of arguments, I think, rather than saying, you know, I mean, one has to, at least I think I made the point, you have to be careful. You know, as asylum, I once wrote a piece about this thing, you know, that often as asylum advocates, it's easy to get into the kind of rhetoric of, well, you know, what, the way they treat women there is barbaric, you know, those are barbaric countries. I mean, you have to be kind of careful of how you exercise that rhetoric too. So I would always tend to emphasize more the kind of the equities that attach to being here and the obligations that governments who have made certain things have to stick by them rather than the other type of one.
To have, you know, these temporary residence status.
Extended.
Well, are there going to be some?
Oh, there definitely will be, and there'll be all sorts of challenges, but you know, TPS is TPS, it's temporary protected status, and it's always renewed, it's renewable, so it isn't a permanent residence, it's not a green card. It was never designed as a green card. So, you know, I mean, this administration has gone, I mean, it's like the diversity lottery. They're going, and this again is going to be a topic of discussion. I mean, they're going for some of the low-hanging fruit, if you like, from a restrictionist point of view. And so I think we on our side have to be very careful about the divide and rule. I mean, I can see that's what's going to happen. I mean, I think Rob disagrees with me. My prediction is that there will be something worked out for the Dreamers at the cost of many other constituencies who are less politically sympathetic. I could be wrong, but that's what I think is, that's, I think, the way the kind of work. So, okay, well, so thank you very much for coming. And do, as Rob said, this is a really an amazing series. And do pick up the lead with us.
And I did tweet links to most of the things that Jackie mentioned. So if you have a Twitter account, you could find the global, a link to the UN Global, the SDG 10-7, and the Global Monday.